So welcome back to the show. You know, I had a different direction where I wanted to take this conversation, but I think that the mood has been set and I have to steer the conversation in a totally different direction. Welcome back to the show. It's Salon Talk. If you just joined us, Su Ocholo
DeRoy of the King.
Of the King.
Yes.
Is in the house, and Bini Ganta is here with me, as well as Baba Luku. If there are any questions whatsoever you want to ask, if there's anything that you've always wondered about Sue, this is the time. Bini Ganta, oh my God, he always looks well put together. What's the secret? This is the absolute time. And Bini and Baba Luku, where has he been? Huh? When all these kids were busy making noise about the industry, how they have founded Lugaflow, how they're giving themselves positions that they shouldn't even be talking about. Where have you been, Baba Luku? Where have you been?
Coming at me like that. I've been here. You know, I've been here and I'm always here. I always tell people there's two sides of the story. So a lot of people don't know that the indigenous youth culture you're witnessing has been heavily steered by diasporic kids. I grew up in Canada. My whole family is in Canada. And so I do time by choice, right? So I decided to come back to Uganda probably about 10 years ago. I made a commitment to say that every year I have to spend at least 4 to 5 months in this country. But the only passion that was bringing me back to Uganda was hip-hop culture and youth. That's been my conversation. I'm still consistent and relevant. So, you know, because we don't like to hoot our own horns or pay off media houses to promote us, we've been here. Okay, I tell people, I got a love and hate relationship with the industry because I'm the most unpromoted artist by choice.
No, but you are also the most underrated artist in this country. I have to tell you this.
You know, whichever way they take it, it's not my concern. I didn't come here to pleasure people. I came here to serve my nation.
Yes.
Represent my ancestors and be proudly African, not even Ugandan. Mm-hmm. Okay? Proudly African.
Unapologetically.
When you grow
up
in the diaspora, you learn you're black.
Yes.
Okay? You're only Ugandan when you're still in Uganda. Once you get the black treatment, you're black everywhere you go. So I know what it is to be black. So when I come to Uganda, I have a sense of responsibility in my spirit and soul for my brothers here and for my diasporic people.
First thing is the culture. It is the image, it is the dream. It is the respect that you want to get with what you're doing. At the end of the day, artists are different. Every artist represents something different. So when you look at it, artists lack most things that are supposed to be started with, like morals from home. Respect God. If you don't respect God, you're not going to represent anywhere positively in the world. If you respect Jah, you're going to do things in the line of Jah. This talent comes from God. You understand? So if I'm an artist, I see myself as an angel.
Would you consider yourself spiritual?
Yeah, of course.
And not religious?
I'm religious and spiritual at the same time. Because why? This music that I do, it comes from, it is light from my God. Because every time before I sing anything, every time I get on the microphone, I just say a prayer like, God, come, let's do this together. He gives me what to sing about. I don't write this down. It doesn't matter whether I write or I don't write. But the whole concept is, where does this come from? If God has given me the talent to represent, I'm supposed to represent myself and represent the community, the people around me. If I do my music, let's take for example, do you know why Baba Luke is still relevant in the industry? You don't hear his songs, but you hear the name. When you hear the name, you still respect.
When you hear the name, you bow down.
You understand what me talk about? Respect. Respect is the most biggest gift you can ever achieve for yourself on this earth, because we don't have life forever, but we can still live even though we are gone. We have artists who are gone, but they still live with us. Their music still lives on with us. Currently, the music, people do music that lasts for 2 months because they want to make money. But at the end of the day, you want to make money. When you get the money, what's next? How have you helped the community? What lives have you changed? How have you inspired people? How many people have you touched with your music? Yes, we can make this money, but at the same time, we can still send the message out there. Let's not focus on just doing music to get us a little bit of money, because let me give you an example. You are an artist, people pay $10,000 to come and see one person, and you walk on the streets, you see like 1,000 people who are just walking and you see them for free. So if you're that special, how are you giving back to the community? Just use your talent, educate, mm-hmm. and entertain.
And use your influence.
Yes, true.
Speaking of influence, Sue, you have quite a bit of that, especially in the fashion industry. Well, you're hearing it from me. I know you have a love of music. Is there any kind of music that, I don't know, I don't even know how to ask you this question, but because we have been conditioned to think, even in our churches, when we go to our churches and then someone releases or someone starts to play a certain kind of music. For example, hip hop has just been recently received by the people who consider themselves spiritual or religious. And up to now, there are people who will not accept anything like hip hop in their churches. Even if young people who decide to go the gospel way are still limited. In your opinion, is there a kind of music that should be done anywhere?
I think music is music. When I feel the beat, I move. Do you know what I mean? I could be in Karamojo and they're banging drums. I feel it, I'll dance to it. I think in the house of God, there shouldn't be any limitations to what kind of beats are there. If you have Afro beats and you have hip hop, we should dance to it in Lingala. You are singing for Jesus or whatever it is. If we're in the club, whatever, let's just dance to it. I don't have a preference, really.
Speaking of club,
yeah.
When is Arab Money coming back?
I do it once a year.
Once a year?
Yeah, in December.
Did we have it last year?
Yes, we did. I have a space in industrial area on 7th Street. We call it 110 on 7th. It's a very, it looks like a meat parking district, New York. That's the kind of thing that we brought back here. Mm-hmm. So we're creating space. We have a coffee shop, we've got me the champagne bar, we've got a nightclub that's called Factory, and then we have my boudoir, the clothing line as well. And then we've got this massive courtyard outside where we do events. We have Quivago that just happened recently, and we have Akadope there, and then Arabani.
So your business is party?
It is not just party. It's lifestyle. It's an experience. Mm-hmm. You know, I want people to walk away and say, do you know what? I just didn't go to Arab Money and danced. I went to Arab Money. I was treated great. I got a VIP experience. You know, there was sand brought in from Dubai. The champagne was a certain temperature. The hostesses were amazing. This is what I don't get in Uganda. The service was impeccable. I'm going to walk away and next year I look forward to coming back.
So you consider yourself setting this trend?
Absolutely. I'm here to bring the experience back here that people that can't afford to get it, mm-hmm. elsewhere in the world, they're getting here.
Have people been receptive?
I sell out. And I don't want as many people. It's a VIP experience. That's the limited tickets. That's why it's once a year, so they should look forward. I have people flying for Arab Money. Yeah. It's a truth.
Yes.
We had King Sah headlining last year. You could ask him, you know, to sell out. And I had someone from Nigeria come in, a lot of DJs. Fenon did the production. And you know, Fenon is not cheap. So when Fenon does your production, that's the kind of quality that we want.
So let me ask you about this lifestyle that you're selling. Mm-hmm. Because that's exactly what you're doing. You're selling lifestyle.
I'm selling a lifestyle.
Like, the problem now is that you're selling the lifestyle that very many Ugandans can't afford.
That's not true.
Very many Ugandans can't afford that lifestyle.
That's absolutely not true. I know a lot of Ugandans mm-hmm. that afford the lifestyle. They buy champagne, they fly business class.
Okay.
All the time.
Okay, that's just like 1%.
Well, because the people that maybe you know, they don't know them.
I represent Abantu, by the way.
They've got so much money. Mm-hmm. But because they don't show it on social media, mm-hmm. you don't know.
That's exactly where I was headed.
Yeah.
That's exactly where I was headed. So we have a trend
yes.
where people have a little bit of money and then they decide everybody needs to know that I earned 10 million.
No.
So I will take pictures of my 10 million and throw it on social media.
I best believe they don't have that money. No, because anyone, let me tell you something. The day you see Bill Gates taking pictures of his money, you know he's gone broke. Simple as. What, there's no other way.
All his money can't fit
so
in one picture.
He's got so much money. The money can't fit on a table. It's insecurities. Why am I taking pictures of $10,000? Because I don't know when I'm going to get it next. So I've been so insecure that I have to take this picture to show the whole world that, oh my God, I got $10,000. Let them see.
You're shaking tables.
No, here's the truth. I'm in industrial area. They can come beat me from there.
See, poverty is such a problem that when people who've grown up without, whether you're in a ghetto or whether you're, you know, mainstream or from, you know, uptown, the reality is that image is what gets people into this predicament. You got people emulating lifestyles that they cannot afford. In hindsight, falling short of their reality. So you can see that a lot of people in Uganda today are in an eluded space. Because where poverty is, someone is trying to feel good. So they, you know, they're going to do the cosmetic, you know, fix up right quick. Make me $1 million rich. You know, take that image and post it up because they want to say, I almost got close to that. But what do we learn from that? It's just the fact that we're living in a society where people are not well. And where we need to use our gifts to continue heightening those experiences so that people could be dignified and they don't have to live such a life. We're literally just fighting image. You know, it's just what I wanted to say. Yeah. And we need to own our own image. You know, we are very rich people.
I am owning mine soon. The Mutuawansi.
And I said Mutuawansi has a lot of money, but they don't flaunt it because their money is real.
Let me clear this out. Yeah. There is no such thing as Mutuawansi.
No.
Mutuawansi is someone under a certain lifestyle. I work in the ghettos. The first time I had Mutuawansi, I was so offended to see a young person tell me that.
Baba.
I'm going to listen.
Can we come back after?
Yes, okay, let's do that.
All right, let's come back.
Let's do that.
Don't go anywhere.
Yeah.